Welcome back to my YouTube channel. My name is Maria. If you enjoy this video after watching, please hit the like button and subscribe to my channel for any future videos on narcissistic abuse and, more importantly, narcissistic abuse recovery. Today we are going to be getting into an interesting topic, but first I want to remind you, in another video I had spoken about CPTSD. This is something we may develop after years of narcissistic abuse. So CPTSD is complex post-traumatic stress disorder. You may have heard of PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. So that PTSD is one isolated traumatic experience that somebody may go through, and then they end up having flashbacks of that experience throughout their life. Complex post-traumatic stress isn't just one incident, one traumatic incident. This incident happens over a period of time. So, such as narcissistic abuse that could happen over the duration of your childhood, or maybe over the duration of a relationship or marriage that you may have been in. So, this is what CPTSD. Now, there are five different symptoms or categories of CPTSD, five different ways in which CPTSD shows up in your life. We have made videos on the other four. This is going to be the fifth video that we are going to be making in this series. If you want to check out the rest, just go ahead on my channel under the category of CPTSD. So number one, we looked at toxic shame. Number two, a vicious inner critic. Number three, emotional flashbacks. Number four, social anxiety. And today we are going to be getting into number five, which is self-abandonment. So, best way to let you know about self-abandonment. When we are younger, we may have been abandoned by a toxic parent or caretaker. And by abandoned, I mean emotionally abandoned, psychologically, physically, maybe one or maybe all of these. So because of that, when we get older, we tend to abandon ourselves. Now, this is kind of like when you're a child, if you had narcissistic caretakers, you tend to get into narcissistic relationships with lovers or, you know, boyfriends, girlfriends, marriages as you get older, because we do what we are familiar with, right? So we're used to this kind of treatment where we love the love bombing and then we get into these narcissistic relationships. Well, self-abandonment is kind of like that. So it's something that is familiar to us. So what is self-abandonment? How does that show up in our lives and what does that mean? Self-abandonment basically means that we don't show up for ourselves. We are not there for ourselves. We don't stand up for ourselves. One big way that this shows up in your life is that you tend to suppress emotions. So when something tragic happens in your life, let's say like you go through a divorce, okay, we'll just start there. You go through a divorce. When the divorce is finalized, you may feel like, oh, I feel fine. I can't believe I feel okay. You know, this is strange. You may be suppressing your emotions. You're not taking the time to heal, to grieve, to go through the emotions, to feel the emotions. You're hiding them somewhere deep down inside. It's so painful for you that you can't bear to feel it. But that is a form of self-abandonment. When we are showing up for ourselves, we're actually feeling emotions, we're processing the emotions, and we are able to move forward from there. So this is a form of self-abandonment, okay? If you're somebody that represses your emotions, you don't process emotions. And this also, I mean, this isn't your fault that you do this. This is also because when you were emotionally abandoned as a child, you weren't taught how to process emotions. This is something that you have to learn to do by reparenting yourself, by reteaching yourself to do this. And at the end of this video, I'll leave you with some tools that you can use if you choose to go through that process. And excuse me if I look down at my notes, okay, I'm gonna be looking at them for you. So, something that happens a lot of times when we repress emotions is that we go into one of the four F trauma responses. So, fight, flight, freeze, or fawn. And these emotions that we are repressing, they can come out as anger towards other people, towards people at your work, your job. You may seem sad, depressed, angry, upset, or maybe you go into the flight response where you just completely want to flee the situation. Maybe you get into a relationship with someone new right away because that to you is easier than processing the feelings. A lot of people who repress emotions and they go into the flight response develop addictions to drugs, alcohol, sugar, television, and this is just something to numb. You're actually self-medicating so that you don't have to feel the pain. You will do whatever you have to do to not feel the pain, but remember, this pain is going to show up in other areas of your life. A lot of times this pain shows up in illness. Sickness is in the body. 30% of the people that are seen at the hospital are seen for stress-related problems and illnesses. So stress is a real thing, and when we repress emotions, this comes out of our body in different ways and different illnesses, unfortunately. So we need to be very mindful about our feelings. We need to, when something happens to us, we really need to sit down with ourselves and spend time alone, really see how we feel. I encourage you to journal. If you don't like the word journaling, I encourage you to write down your feelings, look at them, keep writing. How do you feel? You will be amazed at when you start journaling and writing things down at what actually comes out of your thought process. And this may help you to organize your thoughts, all right? To see them on paper. Helps. Another thing that's really important when you deal with self-abandonment problems is to keep the right people around. Keep your inner circle tight and keep people in your life that you know you can trust. When you form a friendship with somebody, take it slow. Okay, we're not into jumping into relationships, jumping into friendships, because what does that happen? What happens to us when we do that? We end up getting hurt. When we get hurt, it makes us suppress our emotions even more. Over time, they're just so built up. We have emotions up to here, and we can't let new people into our lives because of all the hurt that we have dealt with in our life, right? I can attest to that. I have gone through that as well. So we need to focus on what is within. And a lot of times when we deal with self-abandonment, we lose our identity. We don't know who we are because all those tough times that you're supposed to be going through when you process your emotions, you're skipping over all of that. So you're skipping over these milestones that you can get through to build yourself stronger and stronger and stronger and to get to know yourself more and more and more. You're skipping all that part. And I know that this may reflect in the fact that you may not know who you are as a person because you have not gone through these appropriate steps. Something to look forward to is, are you someone that isn't able to say no? You say yes to everything because you know that it's going to make the other person happy. Even though it's something that you don't want to do, you continue to say yes because you're not showing up for yourself. You're not putting yourself first. You're putting somebody else before you, right? So that's something else that you may notice if you're somebody that tends to self-abandon. Do you hide how you feel? Do you hide your feelings? Do you not want to talk to people about your feelings because you feel like it might burden them? It might show up in this way. Do you feel like your feelings don't actually matter? See, this isn't true. Your feelings do matter. You're not burdening other people. This is something you picked up from childhood. This isn't actually a reality. A lot of times our thoughts are not telling us the truth, and in this case, that's what's happening. You're bringing this in from your childhood. Do you allow people to treat you badly? Do you allow spouses to treat you badly? Do you allow friends, teachers, co-workers, and you don't say anything? You would rather not say anything and say, I'm afraid of conflict, than standing up for yourself. That is not showing up for yourself, okay? This, again, is something that you learned. You don't like conflict because at some time in your life, when you had conflict with somebody, they yelled at you, they weren't happy with you, they were mad at you, and you said to yourself, it would be better for me to just say nothing than to feel that pain. So you don't want to feel the pain. So fear is ruling your life. Like you live off of fear. You don't want to say things to people. You don't want to say the wrong things. You're scared of people. You might be scared of social interactions. Scared of applying for that new job. You live your life off fear, possibly when we self-abandon, right? So we want to change this, right? Because we don't want to have anxiety, we don't want to have depression, all over self-abandonment and CPTSD. It's a lot of work to get out of this. Okay, so plan on putting the work in, really researching, and more importantly, healing. So using your tools. One thing that you can do is develop a compassionate inner dialogue. Talk to yourself better than how you feel. Tell yourself things. I am beautiful. I am smart. I am independent. I can get that job. It doesn't matter if you don't believe these things. The more you say something over and over again, the more your subconscious mind is used to hearing it, and eventually your subconscious mind will believe it. These negative thoughts that you're thinking all the time, these compulsive negative inner critic thoughts, will be replaced by a compassionate inner critic. It just takes work. Okay, meditation, also a great thing to help with self-abandonment. Spending time by yourself, being quiet and spending time by yourself. A healthy diet, exercise, self-care, just doing nice things for yourself. Show up, show up. I mentioned journaling, facing your fear, and I'm gonna say this is a really, really important one. Walk away from toxic people. Walk away from toxic relationships in your life. No matter what you need to do, life is very, very short. Okay, so we don't need to spend time with toxic people in our lives. I think we've done that long enough. So walking away from toxic people is for sure gonna move your healing process along. Okay, guys, thank you so much for spending this time with me today. I really appreciate it. Again, if you like this video, go ahead and hit the like button and subscribe to my channel for any future videos on narcissistic abuse. And important, narcissistic abuse recovery. Don't forget to use your tools. Okay, guys, just like always, thank you so much for coming, and I wish you all the love in the world.